Welcome. In this class, we would focus on the economic importance of bacteria and fungi. Now, bacteria belongs to Monera and fungi belongs to fungi in the kingdom classification, as we had seen. Understanding about bacteria first, the general characteristics. It's unicellular, one of the most primitive, does not have true nucleus, has a capability to form colonies. It does not have organelles. So it's a prokaryoid by definition. We have understood about prokaryoids in our previous lecture. Talking about the nutrition, it could be autotrophic or heterotrophic. That means it has a capability to produce its own food in certain circumstances and in certain forms of bacteria, and in others, it depends on others for its food. It is usually found everywhere. It has an extremely simple structure and a large surface volume ratio. That means smaller size increases the surface ratio, and this is one of the reasons that it is more resistant to the adverse environmental factors, and therefore there is also diversity in the nutrition that is seen. The next is some of the useful bacteria that we would talk about. The most common example is curd, which is prepared from milk sugar converting into lactic acid, and the bacteria is lactobacillus. Similarly, curing of cheese is another example. Tea leaves, the processing of tea leaves, which includes curing and ripening, is aided by bacteria. In the leather industry, also for the tanning purposes, bacteria are used where fermentation for the tanning is done by bacteria. Similarly, for retting the fibers of jute, hemp, Clostridium butulicium is used, which is again a bacteria. For the manufacturing of vinegar, Acetobacter aceti is used. Bacteria are used for preparation of antibiotics. Tetramycin, streptomycin are some common examples. Similarly, fungi are also used for preparation of antibiotics. Gruciflavicin is one of the common examples. Preparation of vaccines for immunity purpose, there is again where bacteria are used. Serum is again important for by specific bacterial infection, serum is obtained. And how this is obtained is very interesting. Any healthy animal, it could be a horse or a rabbit, they are given small doses, and when they are given small doses at regular interval, their body starts to produce antitoxins to neutralize the effect. That is extracted, and from that extraction serum is prepared. This serum has the antibodies. Now this serum can be stored at low temperature, and since the serum contains the antibodies, it is used to prevent further specific bacterial infection. Coming on to the plant system, we can say bacteria have a very important role in fixation of nitrogen. Rhizobium in the root nodules fix the free nitrogen into nitrate. Now there is a process which is known as nitrification. Very, very important. Nitrification is conversion of ammonia into nitrate. Now it does not take place all of the sudden. Ammonia gets converted into nitrite. Nitrite gets converted into nitrate. So ammonia into nitrite and nitrite into nitrate, two different bacteria are used or are involved. From ammonia to nitrite, it is nitrosomonas, and from nitrite to nitrate, it is nitrobacter. So two different bacteria are part of it. Water which is absorbed by the roots is where the process of nitrification starts. Then there is another process which is known as denitrification. Denitrification involves conversion of nitrates into free nitrogen, and this is done by pseudomonas. So nitrosomonas and pseudomonas, not to confuse. Pseudomonas is used for denitrification, converting nitrate back to free nitrogen, right? And conversion of ammonia to nitrite by nitrosomonas, nitrite to nitrate by nitrobacter. Extremely important question commonly asked. Now, bacteria are also scavengers in the nature. They keep the environment clean by increasing the fertility of the soil, as we had already seen. So increasing the nitrogen in the soil, the nitrogen fixing bacteria as they act as, they are very, very useful. But on the other hand, bacteria are also responsible for certain diseases. For example, typhoid, tetanus, tuberculosis, diphtheria in animals. Similarly, anthrax, blackleg, cholera of chicken. Similarly, these are some of the other diseases which are found in animals. In humans, it is typhoid, tetanus, tuberculosis. Similarly, in plants, we do have leaf spots. Then there is soft root or bacterial galls, as it is said. So those are some of the common bacterial diseases in plants. Spoilage of a food is a common example of bacterial infection. Similarly, food poisoning is again associated with harmful bacteria. Two important bacteria responsible for food poisoning: Clostridium botulinum and Salmonella tympanum. So Salmonella and Clostridium botulinum are the two important ones. Similarly, bioweapons are another important thing that you must be familiar with. So weapons of mass destruction, when we say, in that we talk about nuclear weapons. There is another segment which is called as bioweapons. In the case of bioweapons, anthrax is a common disease which is used as a bioweapon. Anthrax is spread by Bacillus anthracis, and this is again a role of harmful bacteria. So we have talked about useful bacteria and a summary about harmful bacteria. When there is an incomplete breakdown of organic matter by bacteria, it emits foul smell, and this foul smell, this process is known as putrefaction. Putrefaction is another important process. Now, a very important difference understanding between bacteria and fungi. Now, once we understand that, we would go into the details of some fungi, useful fungi as well. So bacteria, the diameter is relatively small. It is a prokaryote. However, fungi is a eukaryote. Bacteria does not have true nucleus. It is without cell organelles, that is without mitochondria, endoplasmic reticulum. But fungi does have those. In fungi, sterols are present. The cell wall of the fungi is made of chitin. In the case of bacteria, sterols are not present. The cell wall is made of peptidoglycan. Very, very important. The bacterial cell wall is peptidoglycan. The fungal cell wall is chitin. Bacteria does not proliferate. However, for fungi to proliferate, spores are required. There is dimorphism, which is seen in fungi, but not in bacteria. And the fungi requires carbon and no anaerobes for the process of metabolism. Now, bacteria are unicellular. As I mentioned, they are autotrophic as well as heterotrophic. Fungi are extremely heterotrophic and have extracellular digestion. Now in fungi, the reproduction happens by budding, branching and spore formation. Very, very important. So asexual reproduction in fungi happens by budding, branching and spore formation. The sexual reproduction occurs by conjugation. There is endospore or spore formation in the case of fungi. Some of the important antibiotic for the same: Griseofulvin, which is a antibiotic prepared from fungi, is used for athlete's foot, ringworm and fungal infections. Similarly, there is cephalosporium, and that is useful for pneumonia, meningitis and gonorrhea. The next is, here we have a list of diseases and the bacteria that cause it. So staphylococci causes boils, vibrio cholera causes cholera. These are some important ones, so just remember those. Diplococci causes pneumonia and meningitis. Diplococci pneumoniae causes pneumonia, and diplococci causes meningitis. Similarly, Bacillus tuberculosis causes tuberculosis, and Bacillus typhosis causes typhoid. Again, important. So, which bacteria causes which infection is important. Coming on to fungi, let's talk about the useful fungi. So, fungi is one of the good example of useful fungi is yeast. Mushroom, that is edible. Now it's non-green, it grows on dead organic matter, and usually in a warm, damp atmosphere, there is growth of mushroom, yeast and molds. Now among them, bread mold in the two forms, mucor and rhizopus. Mucor is known as pin mold and rhizopus is called as black mold. Both of them are saprophytic. They digest the food outside their body, and therefore they are called as it is called as extracellular digestion, and they do not prepare their own food, so they are heterotrophs as well. So under fungi, we talk about heterotrophic extracellular digestion. Now, this Digested food is absorbed by hyphae and then is stored in two forms, either glycogen or oil droplets. Now, there is a network of mycelium which is formed, and this network of mycelium has cell wall. This cell wall is rich in chitin. There is no chlorophyll. It is non-motile and reproduces asexually. Now, both of these, mucor and rhizopus, are important. They have branched hyphae. The cell wall is made of cellulose. Aseptate hyphae is seen. That means the cytoplasm is not partitioned into separate cells. It is aseptate, and therefore we call it as aseptate hyphae. It is not partitioned. There is no specific or different septa. The hyphae is also cenocytic, that means it is multicellular. So the hyphae is multicellular and it is aseptate, that means it is not partitioned into different compartments. Now, there are three components. One is the stolon for the fungi itself. So, stolon is one which runs parallel. In mucor, this stolon is not present. In rhizopus, it is present. So, stolons run parallel to the ground. Then there are hyphae, which are root-like structure, and opposite to hyphae, what grows is sporangiophores. Sporangiophores grow on the top, hyphae towards the root side. So respiration in the case of fungi is aerobic. Fungi oxidizes the food in presence of oxygen, and therefore it is an aerobic respiration. Now, as it gets the air, then there is bread molds which spread out through the spore formation process. The next is yeast. Yeast are unicellular. Saccharomyces is a good example. The shape of Saccharomyces is simple, ovoid. It does have a cell wall of chitin. There is nucleus and nucleolus. The cytoplasm is granular and has again the glycogen and oil droplets. As we said, the food is stored as glycogen and oil droplets. Sometimes they do respire anaerobically, that means in the absence of oxygen, but they when they are respiring anaerobically, they produce carbon dioxide and ethyl alcohol. This is the process of fermentation. So fermentation does occur here. Now, yeast are used as a nutritional supplement for vitamin B and vitamin E. Very, very important. For research, Saccharomyces cerevisiae has been used. It has been identified with nearly 6,000 genes which are responsible for rapid multiplication and have an important role in genetic research in molecular biology. The next is the plant diseases. Now, under the plant diseases, the yeast, the diseases that are caused in the crucifers is known as white rust. In grapes, it is downy mildew. In potato, it is late blight. Late blight of potato was one of the causes of Irish famine. Similarly, rust in wheat, smut in maize. So the name of the diseases, the disease and its association to the plant is very, very important. So rust in wheat, smut in maize, downy mildew in grapes, late blight in potato, white rust in crucifers. Then we have leaf spots in groundnut. So those are some of the diseases which are caused by yeast in plant. Yeast is also responsible for tropical deterioration. That means what happens in tropical and subtropical regions is due to damp atmosphere, there is growth of fungi. This growth of fungi is commonly seen on clothing, leather material, on photographic plates, and leads to spoiling of those content. And this is therefore called as tropical deterioration, found specifically in tropical areas. The next is mushrooms. Mushrooms are largest of all the fungi. There are three common mushrooms we talk about: button mushroom, oyster mushroom, large fleshy whitish bodies, and then we do have poisonous mushrooms in the form of toadstool, fly agaricus, and death cap. The button mushroom is the most popular mushroom. They are abundantly seen in rainy months in the damp soil. They have umbrella-like structure with flat gills on the lower surface. Mushrooms are seen during the winter months in the plain areas, throughout the year in the hilly areas. So mushroom cultivation is again a very important form of economy. The houses where mushrooms are cultivated is well ventilated. The compost on which mushroom is cultivated is prepared from what is a very important question. So paddy and wheat straw is used. Chicken manure is used, ammonium sulfate is used, and urea is used. Now, together all these, there is dark brown color for 1 week, which is created, and this is at a temperature of 50 degrees Celsius. Now, this compost is filled into various trays, which are 3 to 4 tiers, and then they are left for a few days. After a few days, they are now useful as a compost. They are used for the growth of mushrooms. They provide humidity and also regulate the temperature within the formation. So there is, after 15 to 20 days of casing, there is the first crop in the head which is visible. Now small buttons start to develop 5 to 6 days after the pinhead stage. Full grown mushrooms are then harvested, and then there is increased, this is increased by vacuum cooling and freezing of the solution, which takes place, and this solution involves ascorbic acid, citric acid, and brine. This is how the mushrooms are artificially cultivated. So mushrooms are rich in protein. They are rich in vitamin B, E, and have around 15% protein. So this is again an important way where mushrooms are used. Now, food preservation. Food preservation can take place in various ways. By high temperature, we can sterilize it. So the bacteria and the spores get killed about 110 degrees Celsius. And this is how canning of fruits and juices are done. The next is dehydration or drying, that is removing the water from milk powder and green peas. So powdered milk, how it is created? It is dehydrated by spraying the milk in a heated chamber through which a hot gas passes. And this accumulates as particle on the floor. The next is salting. This process is also known as curing. So preparation of pickles and vegetables is done by it. Pasteurization of milk to make it bacteria free or contamination free is done by two methods. One is at 62 degrees for 30 minutes. The other is at 70 degrees for 15 seconds. And then it is chilled quickly. This process is known as pasteurization. Irradiation is a process where we use x-rays or gamma rays, and that is to kill the small microorganisms. This is used for fruits, vegetables, meat, and fish. Refrigeration can be done. That is another way of preservation. So for domestic refrigeration, it is 0 to minus 5 degrees Celsius. For industrial purpose, it is minus 18 to minus 30. Then for preservation. Now, preservation, pickles, jam, jelly, squash, ketchup, all of these are prepared by preservatives. Now, preservatives, what are used? Salt is a good preservative, sugar, vinegar, citric acid, mustard oil, benzoic acid, sodium benzoate, ascorbic acid, propionic acid are some good preservatives which are used. So, in this section, we have talked about the economic importance of bacteria and fungi, the ways under which food preservation can take place. Some of the topics are extremely important to memorize. For example, the two methods of pasteurization, the temperature and the duration for the same, the various ways of food preservation. Similarly, talking about some of the important yeast, for example Saccharomyces, the cultivation of mushroom, how it is done, the process of casing, the compost for mushroom, what it incorporates is again an important question. Then the list of useful bacteria and disease causing bacteria. So I hope this session was useful. We'll be covering the remaining sections on biology soon. Stay tuned.